Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Appreciate you attending. I was in Connecticut Saturday afternoon with our women's basketball team, and I received a call from Mike Hopkins late in the afternoon, at which time he informed me that he would take the head coach position at Washington. Mike accepting that position clearly changed the dynamics of the succession plan that had been put into place and we had followed. I thought it was critical for us to move quickly and maintain as much continuity as possible. That led me to recommend to the chancellor and board members that we ask Jim to extend his contract and also work to retain two talented assistant coaches in Adrian Autry and Jerry McNamara. Moving quickly was important for our current student athletes as well as our future student athletes. After receiving approval from the chancellor and board members, I returned from Connecticut yesterday, and Jim and I met in the afternoon. At that time, I asked Jim to stay on and to extend his deal, to which he accepted that opportunity, and also to keep Adrian and Jerry on our staff. The success of Syracuse basketball is truly unique, and I'm very confident that the success that we've all enjoyed and our fans have enjoyed for 4+ decades will continue. I also want to thank Mike Hopkins for his contributions to our program. I wish Mike, Trish, and their family much success and happiness in Washington. Coach.
Thank you, John. I will, before I answer questions, there's just a couple points that, obviously I would like to make. There's a lot of misinformation out there, and I think it's important that people get the right information. I kid a little bit about my retirement date. I always have, because I think, first of all, I was never sure in the last 5 years whether I would come back. I always was thinking, will this be the last year? Will this be the right time? That was not to kid around, or that was not to try to get a reaction. I really, pretty much for the last 5 to 8, 10 years, I would think about it after the season and come back. When this agreement was made with the chancellor and me and Mike Hopkins, I fully knew that next year would be my last year. I never, ever thought anything else, ever. I've never tried to change that in any way, shape, or form. I was thrilled that Mike Hopkins would be the coach here at the end of next year. That was set in stone. It was confirmed by the chancellor. It was confirmed by John. And I didn't talk about it because I don't talk about that. 20 years ago, how many years did I have left on my contract? Obviously, nobody, but if you research that right now, you wouldn't know. Because I've never told anybody how many years I've had on my contract, ever. I don't operate that way. I tell every recruit we recruit, normally, I'm going to coach you. 4 years, 3 years from now, or 4 years from now, 50% of the coaches in this country will not be where they're at. I recruited against a school in our league, and they told me that when I was kind of getting a little older, the coaches from that school said, well, he won't coach you. Well, not only am I still coaching, there's been three coaches at that school since that time, two while the player was there. So you never know for sure. And also, a big conversation is about secession. There's 350 schools in the country. I don't know of one of them that has a secession plan, including Duke, North Carolina, UCLA, Kansas, Florida State, Florida, or name any other school. I don't think it's necessary. We did it here because of Mike Hopkins. But at no time, I want to make this clear, did I ever think I was not going to be done next year. It never has entered my mind. And anybody that would write that is writing fiction, which is fine if that's what you want to be known for. writing fiction. Now that I've gotten that out, when Mike came to me at 3 o'clock Saturday afternoon in tears and said, I got an unbelievable opportunity. It was the first I'd heard about it because he wanted to do this and bring it to me when he made a decision, which is what he should have done. And he said, I've got a chance to go to Washington. I was so happy because he was happy. That was my only thought. Mike Hopkins is like a son to me. Anybody that thinks I wouldn't want him to get what he wants does not know me or does not know anything. He was so happy with the opportunity to go to a great school on the West Coast where his father went to school and to have that opportunity to start from scratch. And I couldn't be happier for him. He's met a huge amount to the Syracuse basketball program. And through the years, name the Rick Pitinos and the Troy Weavers and Rob Murphys and Mike Hopkins, this program wouldn't be what it is without those guys. And now we have two unbelievable young coaches, Adrian Autry and Jerry McNamara, who are unbelievable. So I'm so happy for Mike. And when John came to me and talked to me about what the future looked like, if I was 60 years old, there'd be nobody asking a question. So I'm 72, now there's a question? Isn't there an age discrimination law someplace in this country? And then some people write, well, they were 19 and 50, 19 and 40. We were one game away from the tournament. I think everybody knows that. We didn't have a great year, but we battled through it, and we win one more game, we're in the tournament. There's a team in Ohio, Xavier, that lost 6 of the last 7 games, almost didn't get in. But they got in. Where are they now? They're in the Sweet 16. There's a team in South Carolina, lost 5 of their last 7 games. Where are they now? They're in the Sweet 16. And can advance, like we did last year. So we were pretty close. I don't think even the most ardent critic would doubt that. With 4 new players and a sophomore in the starting lineup. So I think we're in good position. People think our recruits aren't that great. Yeah, well, they didn't think Hakeem Warwick was great either. I like our recruits. I think Matt Moyer benefited from this year. I think he's worked hard. I think he's improved. I think he will be ready. I think we have the backcourt that we would have had this year, next year, with another year's experience. Tyus Battle has proved himself. Frank Howard has shown that he can do some tremendous things, and I'm confident that he will have a Scoop Jardine turnaround where people went from booing to cheering for him between his sophomore and junior year. I think that same thing will happen. Torian Thompson averaged over 30 minutes, 16 points a game. Projected over 30 minutes, played 17 minutes a game. I think he's going to be a tremendous player. I think that Pascal will be healthy, perfectly healthy, and be back. Again, I like our freshmen. I'm not going to go through them all, but I think they're all talented. We're not done recruiting. You never are. Last year at this time, we said we weren't done, and we added 2-3 guys. So who knows what will happen in recruiting. We're ready to go to work and add guys, and I believe we will. But I believe we have the nucleus of a very good team. If Tyler Lydon decides to stay in the draft or go in the draft, put his name in permanently, which he could do. We knew that 6 months ago. We knew that a year ago. So we prepared for that. He's been great for us. He's been a great player. I always think players should stay another year because I think it benefits them. but that's his decision, his family's decision, and we'll love him and respect him because he brought a lot to our basketball program, and I think our basketball program helped a kid who nobody knew who he was when he signed here. So that's what you do. That's what colleges do. They help guys get to where they want to go, and you know, it's always, I advise players, but it's always their decision where they, when they should go, and we support them 100%. We don't have to agree with it. We just have to support that decision. But I'll be very happy for him because he's a great kid. I just want to make sure before I take questions that I have to write things down now because I'm 72. Of course, a lot of people write things down that aren't true, but that's something else. I would just close by saying I've never been more excited about a season than I am next year. College basketball is a great thing right now. Anything can happen. I will remind you that in 2002, we went to the NIT. And I think everybody knows what happened in 2003. That's the way I prefer to think, rather than the people who are saying they've had two bad years, so they'll probably have another one. The reason those people say that is because they can't coach. We'll take questions.
You raise your hand. Yes, go ahead.
Coach Boeheim, was there ever a time during the year that you and Coach Hopkins discussed his future here at SU?
Not once. We knew his future here. Well, before when he had the agreement, he interviewed at Southern Cal because he thought he wanted to get back there and he liked that job and he wanted that job. He was contacted about three or four other jobs that he was not interested in. I think that this job, and again, I'm just going by what I talked with Mike about on Saturday. You need to ask Mike, but What I think is that he got an opportunity that's a tremendous opportunity to build a program. And I think that that was appealing to him. I've talked to him two or three times today about things that he's doing and trying to do. We are like father and son in a lot of ways. And I'll be asking him things, and he'll ask me things from now on. And but I think in his mind, this was a great new opportunity. And I can only say this, for the fourth time probably, that I was 100% content for this coming year to be my last year. I wanted to, as I've said before, but I think I should repeat, I wanted to get through everything we had to get through, get established, get some players here, get guys that we were comfortable with, and leave this program in a good position. And I think that's what my only goal and motivation was. And but I think Mike liked this opportunity. Just call, be like Trump, just call on the people we like. Yeah. Don't call. There's one, yeah, Neil. Neil Gold, question, no.
Jim, you mentioned that for the 5 years you kind of thought afterwards.
Probably 10 years.
Why 2 years ago did you want to put it in writing that next year would be your
I did not put it in writing.
Said that you intended to retire?
I don't think that was exactly the wording. I think what the only thing, you know, there was a common agreement between the chancellor and myself that 3 years would be a good time. I did not want to make it public. I thought that was a mistake because it hurts recruiting. But because I don't run things here, I was overruled. And it was fine. We worked through it. We prepared everybody, every recruit and everything for what was going to happen. But I was perfectly content to coach the 3 years. But now that this has occurred, this change has occurred, I'm happy that it has turned this way, because I'm pretty excited about what's going to happen the next 2 or 3 years. And, you know, we've played in the NIT 6 times, 7 times, I don't know. We don't like it, but it's better than not being invited to the NIT like a lot of good programs are, because they're not good enough to get there. And if that's the down year, then we'll work really hard to bounce back from it. There are more losses in general now because of the competition of the leagues. You're not going to go 28-4 unless you've got a great team. And there will be those. But in our league, I mean, Duke has never I don't know if Duke's ever finished fifth in the ACC, or it's been a long time. But it's reality. It's just competitive. It's tough. And, you know, it's just the way of college basketball. You're going to lose more games. And even going back in the history of the Big East, there were plenty of years that we lost 10, 11 games. It was that competitive. But bottom line is, I'm really excited to go forward, and the players we have coming back and the staff we have, and we will get somebody else in recruiting. We will hire a very good assistant coach and move forward.
Chris, I just want to reiterate. I want to reiterate one thing that you and others have asked about is, number one, when I did my due diligence before I accepted this position, one of the things that I wanted to fully understand is what was in place. And there were agreements with Coach Boeheim. There was agreement with Coach Hopkins, too. So there were agreements that set the timeline and very clear and very defined agreements there. In the time that I've been here, Jim has been nothing but supportive of that transition, of trying to make it as seamless as possible for Mike and his staff. So that has been the conversations that he and I have had. And periodically I would meet with Mike one-on-one, and that was always about, all right, you know, starting to plan in our thoughts for 2 years forward. And I said repeatedly, one of the things that when I was here is to execute a transition plan that had been put in place. And that was absolutely what everyone was doing, and we were working together on it. And then Saturday, the dynamic changed, you know, and hence, you know, where we are today and why we asked Jim to extend, and I'm pleased that he did.
And just because I didn't see you here earlier, Bud, and I don't know if you heard me, I fully intended 100%, 100% to leave after next year. Oh, okay. Well, I didn't know. I didn't. You were in a different position, so. No, that's what the normal perception is, but it's not true if you're good, and Mike is good. Mike would have done well here. I have no question about that, because he's good. Sometimes when a successful coach leaves, let's take for example, Dean Smith. They hired somebody who really wasn't able to do the job, right? Then they hired somebody that's better than Dean Smith, right? So the specter of Dean Smith didn't hurt Roy Williams. Everybody picks the one like John Wooden. Well, yeah, it's hard to replace that guy. You're not going to win 10 national championships. But Mike Hopkins and whoever does come after me will be successful here, because we have a great fan base. We have great facilities. We have great administration. We have a great school. We have a great league. I just am not in a hurry. Well, first of all, we have two guys who have already proven that they can recruit, that have already signed recruits, and that's always important. Before, when Troy Weaver was here, he got a guy named Carmelo Anthony. You know, how are you going to replace him? Well, Rob Murphy came in and got a bunch of good players. And then when he left, somebody else came in and got good players. Adrian Autry came in and got Jeremy Grant. And then we got Tyler Ennis. And then now this year, Adrian got two really good players, and Jerry got a really good center from New Jersey. So assistant coaches are important. Players generally go to the program. To use other schools as an example, I don't care who recruits at North Carolina, they're going to get players. And the same for Kansas, the same for a lot of schools. UCLA was on bad times, but those kids went, Lonzo Ball went there because it's UCLA. Kids are going to come to Syracuse, but you have to do the work. And we have two guys that have proven already that they can do the work, and we will hire somebody who has proven that he can do the work. No. Never has. We try to get the best guy. If he happens to be a Syracuse guy, that's great. But it doesn't have to be. Troy Weaver was a great assistant coach, as was Rob Murphy, and I can name a few others. But we'll get the best we can get for this position.
Yeah, Mike will handle that at the appropriate time. Right now the focus is on what we did and what we announced yesterday for this coming year and for the short and midterm of the program. And then ultimately, when that time comes, Coach and I will sit down and we'll figure that out.
Jim, did you like the public head coach designate situation, or would you rather avoid that?
It's up to John. It didn't bother me. I was fine with it. Mike was, as long as I liked the guy, thought it was the right guy. It was my idea, so I guess I had to like the guy. I better like the situation. I thought of it. But it's not, like I said earlier, that's why I said that in the beginning. I don't know if, I'm sure there is, but I'm just going to go on a limb here. There's 350 schools. I don't think there's a head coach designate out there. Could be wrong, but I'll take a 10% error margin, and I'll take a 1% error margin. I don't think that's that common.
Mark, I know you don't want to go into detail on it, but is there a specific length of the
great question. I'm going to go by what I said. For 37 years, nobody knew what my contract was. That'll continue.
And I don't want to know.
Yeah. No, that's what I'm saying. Nobody's ever known if there is or not. I'm like the FBI guy who said, I can't discuss that 86 times today because it's underway. There's an investigation underway. There's a contract underway, and we're not going to discuss it.
And, Mark, terms of any of our coaches, those, the contract terms, that's between the coach and the university.
Findings, the
I looked at it from a 360-degree perspective, and ultimately, you know, my recommendation was what I thought was in the best interest of the program. And this is the result of that. I think this is in the best interest of the program. When I came here, before I came here, again, one of the things I did in the due diligence is, you know, on the compliance side. And the chancellor, when he assumed his position, you know, stressed the importance of that, and we stress it and we live by it every day. And every coach, every assistant coach, every administrator knows that. The first coaches meeting I had, it was one of the first things that I addressed. So it's you know, it's always, you know, it's always top of mind, and I'm confident in the program that we run here at Syracuse across all our sports.
Were the findings in that report taken into consideration?
Again, I looked at it 360 degrees.
Also, because John wasn't here then, the time limit had nothing to do with the NCAA investigation. As I'm sure you know, the NCAA does not recommend or get involved in any hiring at any member school. It's against their constitution. And that was never tied in to my discussion with the chancellor, ever.
Jeff, Coach, you were planning that next year was going to be your last year.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mike's leaving and he extends this offer. What kind of walk us through what's going through your head as you're making this decision? You know, last year was going to be next year was going to be my last one. So what's kind of the thought process for you?
My immediate thought was I want to coach. Immediately. I want to continue to coach. I want to keep our staff intact. I want to keep our recruits here. I want to keep the continuity of the program as much as we possibly can. And we are recruiting other people as we speak that we would lose, obviously, if I would not be here. And I felt I didn't think about it to answer your question. I didn't think about it. It was done. I was, again, glad that John, who has been great to work with, came to me with that decision. It was, again, I don't make these decisions. I never have. The university makes them, and I've always been grateful that they thought I was the right coach here. And obviously there's been bumps in the road. Losing on whatever, all kinds of bumps. There always are. And over 40 years, there's going to be a few. The university's always had confidence in me to do a good job, and I think I have. And they know I do my best every year, and that the program does its best every year to represent the university. So I was very proud that John, and grateful that John came to me with that decision, because he didn't have to. But I hope that I can live up to his expectations and make it a good decision that he's made.
Coach, I understand players come and go. But did you have a sit-down with Tyler? Did you talk to him about him signing with an agent? What were those conversations?
Yeah, I talked to Tyler at length today, and I told him it's easy. You know, you go to Chicago and get an evaluation. I don't know if he wants to do that. You know, these are families' decisions. They have to make these decisions. And most people, if you're not a lottery pick, most coaches think you should come back. Most coaches are on record pretty much as saying that. And I'm not going to be different from those coaches. I think if you don't have any chance to be a lottery pick the next year, then maybe, you know. But like with Tyler, I think he could be next year. He didn't demonstrate this year that he can be a lottery pick. But I know he can be. And that's what I told him. I think he can come back and demonstrate that he could be a lottery pick. I think it's a better way to go to the NBA. You make more money. They draft you high, they play you. half the picks between 20 and 30 are out of the league within 3 years. So it's just that's, but it's, again, it comes down to, you know, what he thinks is he wants to do, and then you go forward. I'm just grateful that he's given us the 2 years that he's given us. He's been a huge part of our team and getting to the Final Four and to having a pretty good year this year. Not what we like, but better than could have been, too.
He specifically told you that he signed with an agent?
He did not tell me. No, he specifically told me that he did not sign with an agent as of 1 o'clock. It'll be difficult. Mike's, he's great. He's been a great coach. Like I said, I've known Mike Hopkins since he was 16 years old. He came to our basketball camp. And, he's nobody better than Mike. And, but in this business, if I was 50, I'd be happy he was getting the Washington job. I'd be thrilled, just like when Rick Pitino got the Northeastern job and, Rob Murphy got a head coaching job. You want your coaches to get those jobs. I would have liked for Mike to take over here, but I think he's happy with what he's doing. And that's what's important. It's important for what he wants. And I'm grateful that I have two assistants who've been here. There's some coaches that get a job, they hire three new people. There's other coaches that get a new coach or two a lot. I think Rick Pitino's had 8 assistants since in the last 4 years. I've had the same guys. It's a lot easier. But I'm grateful that I have those guys, and I've got the trainer I have and the strength and conditioning coach I have and the video guy I have and equipment guy I have. It's good. And we'll get somebody good to come in here.
Mike, Jim, I apologize if I kind of missed this, but you said in answer to Matt's question that you 2 years ago said that you intended to coach for 3 more years, that had nothing to do with the NCAA investigation.
Yes.
You said you didn't want to say it publicly. So where did the 3-year number come from? Why did that?
I think it was a number that the chancellor felt comfortable with. He doesn't explain himself to me. You'd have to ask him. Well, he and I talked about it, and he thought that was the number. The only thing we disagreed on was the time, the public, making it public, that's all.
Tim, are you under the impression Mike's going to bring any Syracuse employees with him to Washington?
As of right now, he's not. But, Doug Marone said he wasn't going to take anybody to Buffalo, didn't he? I feel good. Should I be like, wasn't Donald Trump telling Hillary to get a physical or something? Should I get one, you think? I get one every year. I think that, my feel is there's some presidents of monster corporations that have unbelievable responsibilities that are 80 years old. I think Mr. Newhouse, I think I'm right. Still running Newhouse Communication, isn't he? Does anybody know that? I think he's 90, isn't he?
He's up there.
I think he's 90. I mean, I think we're putting ages on people that we shouldn't. I'm not, what I do isn't manual labor. I kind of walk around and talk a lot. And once in a while I get agitated. But I think you could coach until you're 80 if you wanted to. I mean, if you're healthy, why not? You don't get dumber. Hopefully you get smarter. If your enthusiasm level is high, I think mine is pretty high. It might be higher than it's ever been in some ways. And I think your knowledge is pretty good. All programs, you know, go through ups and downs, and you know that happens. But college basketball is competitive. You're not dominating anymore. Nobody's dominating except for there's a couple schools that might be able to, but I think the Oklahoma coach is a great coach. I think he's a great coach, and they didn't have a good year this year. They'll be back next year. They'll bounce back. You know, Texas was picked in the top 25 preseason. They would have liked to get to the NIT. I mean, it's hard. There's going to be some up and downs. And when you get guys leaving early, it makes it difficult. You know, we lost, you know, Malachi hurt. I mean, you know, it hurts to lose guys like that. Pascal's injury, that hurts. You know, it hurts when those things happen. But, you know, it's going to be competitive. It's going to be tough. And you're not going to sail through anymore. That's not happening. Doesn't matter who's coaching here. It's, you know, it's going to be a battle every year. And but you can be just okay getting the tournament and go to the Final Four. We did it. You can go to the Sweet 16. Xavier's doing it. Say, you know, South Carolina's doing it. Those two were dead a little bit in the water. Michigan at one time this year was dead. They found a couple guys stepped up big, and now they're in the Sweet 16. So it's just very, very competitive now. There's no – it used to be I mean, honestly, I felt if we didn't get the Sweet 16, it was like a horrendous year. You know, we went, what, I don't know, 13, 14 times there, and I didn't – some of those years, I didn't even think it was a big deal. It's a big deal now. It's a big deal to win a game. And it's really a big deal to get to the Sweet 16. It's changed. College basketball has changed dramatically. Dramatically changed. I feel better now than I've ever felt, to be honest with you. I have never felt any better. I should knock on wood, right? No, I feel great. I get physical every year. I work out. Pilates, best thing you can do. Been doing it for 4 years. Never felt better.
I was surprised, as we all were, and as Coach was, when Mike told Coach. The weekend became very hectic. You know, after that, I did not receive a heads up from anybody at University of Washington. So immediately, once upon hearing the news, I contacted the chancellor and some board members, and quickly put my thoughts together. To run it by them, and again, as I said at the beginning, is I thought moving quickly, with an emphasis on continuity for the program, doing what's best for the program, being very aware of our current student athletes, our student athletes have committed to play here. What's the best outcome? And I believe this is the best outcome with Jim, and obviously, as Jim has said, Adrian and Jerry. They are two very, very good assistant coaches. So we have a terrific staff, and Jim will add another quality assistant.
And incidentally, both guys have been offered jobs at other schools since Saturday.
Both, you mean right in. And that was the only plan, John? Was Jim?
I thought that was the best plan.
He stuck. He better say that. You know, it would be a good answer. You know, for 20 years, it's been a very similar routine we have. Each coach, like in football, I got a little bit, I hate to borrow from football, but I did a little bit. Each coach has his group, just as in football. That never happened before 20 years. We do that. I know Duke does that. I think some other people do that now. And each coach has his group and works with that group and does film work with that group. And does individual work with that group. But practice is the same as it's been for 40 years. Exactly. I run practice. I mean, they comment, they make suggestions, but I'm the one that yells at, like, John Gillen. I yell at him when he's making mistakes and making the calls during the games and with their input. And each time out, each coach talks to his group, which didn't happen before. That's changed. Prior to the game, I talk to the team, but each coach talks to his group. That's changed. After the game, each coach talks to his group. Jerry with the guards, Red with the forwards, and Mike with the big guys. I think that's been good. I think we do that in the Olympics a little bit, and we do that here, and that's been a change. But as far as practice itself and the games themselves, it's been the same for 40 years. Yeah, recruiting. Each assistant coach has guys he recruits. I'm brought in right away with each guy and each group, each parent, each coach, and I'm involved. They do the legwork. I go to see them all in the summer, and they might be sophomores or juniors or freshmen, whatever. And then we make decisions as to who, you know, we're going to try to go after and who's the best fit. And then each guy will be a primary recruiter of a player, and I'll be involved along the way. And then the home visit, the school visit. And the biggest question, obviously when you've been someplace for a long time, they want to play for me. And, you know, we didn't ever get to the point that was going to be an issue because everybody here is playing for me, and they would be next year. That's how we recruited some of these guys. I'm going to coach you. And Mike had started to transition into the other recruits that you're going to play for me, meaning him. So that's what we've done the last year. And they were all good. I mean, obviously you'll lose somebody because they'll say, well, I wanted to play for coach. You know, that's part of the process. But, you know, that'll go away now. That'll go away now. But that's pretty much a little bit about what's to answer your question, I think. Okay.
Go back to Saturday. You mentioned
Matt, go ahead.
Go back to Saturday. Where were you and Mike when you had this?
My house.
He came over?
Yes.
He had tears in his eyes?
Yeah, well, I should. It's kind of private. But, yeah, I mean, we both did. Yeah. I was so happy. We were sitting down. Yeah. We were sitting down, and I think this is the best for Mike Hopkins. And I can say that because I think he's my son. If my son had come in when my son makes a decision, I look at it as, is that the best thing? I think this is the best thing for Mike Hopkins. I think he would have been great here. I think he'll be great there. But I think that knowing everything, I feel this is a great decision for him. I'm happy for him.
Got time for two more. Chris?
Do you think not wanting to be the guy to push you out played a role in
that
decision?
No, I can't answer that question. And I'm not being, I was not being pushed out. I agreed to, that was good. So that's not what happened, would have happened.
No, my thoughts were there was a transition plan that had been put into place, and my job was to help execute that as effectively, as seamlessly as possible. And that's what I said, and you know, I said that to Jim, I said that to Mike, I said that to everybody else, and that's what we're doing. And Jim just kind of referenced that in terms of recruiting, how Jim was coach recruiting and talking to the kids he was going to recruit, then Mike was out there with kids who ultimately would have played for him. So everybody was 100% on board with what was going to happen. and we're all working together to make that as effective as possible for the overall good of the program.
Thanks, everybody, for coming on short notice. We appreciate it.